which is really good news. So if you got a Bible with you, go ahead and grab it. We're going to be in the book of Revelation again. Revelation chapter 3 now is where we land. If you don't have a Bible with you, there are paperback Bibles in the seats around you, and I encourage you to grab one of those so you can see for yourself exactly what Scripture is saying to us today. We've now, for a month, really since the start of the year, been here in the book of Revelation. We've heard, so many opinions today, right? And there were so many opinions in the first century. And there were so many ideas, and everybody had their soapbox. And I could easily get up here today and give easily, maybe like three of you would even like it, give you my soapbox spiel, okay? But what we have in the midst of all these opinions and all these spiels and all these perspectives is Jesus himself in Revelation 1, the revelation of him coming to us and telling us what the church is supposed to be and how we're supposed to function as believers. How we're supposed to live in this broken and jacked up world that infiltrates the church oftentimes. And like I already said, that's really good news for us. That's really good because my spiel and my perspective and my soapbox and your opinion ultimately do no good. Right. Just do us no good. The words of the one who died and lives again does us great good. And so let's see what he has to say this morning. He already addressed four churches in Revelation chapter 2. And so for those who have lost the preeminent love, maybe you're still faithful and you're serving and you're theologically sound and you're in your Bethmore Bible studies and you're reading John Piper and all that stuff's going on, but you have abandoned or walked away from or neglected the love that is supposed to be preeminent in your life, the love for Jesus, the word to you was the word to the church of Ephesus. Reclaim that. Reclaim that. Or maybe you are bearing opposition, ridicule, false accusation for the sake of Christ, for the kingdom of God, like the church at Smyrna was. And the word to you today is remain faithful. Just remain there. Or maybe, like the church at Pergamum, you begun to assimilate to the culture around you, and so restoration to the way is called for. Return to the way. Or maybe it's renewal, like we saw with the church at Thyatira a couple weeks ago. To be renewed in our most holy faith and our devotion to Christ Jesus. Or maybe you're watching online today, or maybe you're here in this place, and you need the painful and alarming word to the church at Sardis. And here it is. Chapter 3, verse 1. And to the angel, the messenger, the pastor, the one who carries the message of the gospel forward of the church, in Sardis write. So we pause here like we've done every week because we're going to understand the context of why Jesus is saying what he's saying and giving the directive that he's giving and revealing himself in the way that he's revealing himself. We need to understand a little bit contextually of the city of Sardis. So I'll throw up the map again. We've visited it pretty much every week. But this is the ancient, literally the ancient postal routes beginning there in the most prominent city in Asia. The city of Ephesus, right there on the Aegean, they received the letter of revelation, not seven letters, it's one letter, the letter of the revelation of Jesus Christ, and there's a word for them there, and you go about 60 miles to the north to the city of Smyrna, this jewel of ancient Asia, beautiful city, direct access port city to Athens, and then you go to the north to the ancient capital city of Pergamum, and then over to the east, to Thyatira, this really insignificant, kind of marginalized, non-notable city. And then down to the south, about 35 miles to the city of Sardis. And Sardis was, like many of these cities, absolutely spectacular. And what had made it so spectacular, its infrastructure and architecture, was the fact that gold was in abundance there in the area. Flowing right through the center of the city of Sardis was the Pactolus River. And it was said in antiquity that you could go down to the Pactolus and you could just dip your hand into the waters, and from the riverbed you could draw up a fistful of gold. And so it became an incredibly wealthy city in the 6th century BC, about 600 years before John writes the book of Revelation. The first coins ever were minted in the city of Sardis. It is literally the birthplace of modern money. The richest man in the ancient world was a man named Croesus. You might have actually heard it. It's still a phrase that's used at times today, rich as Croesus. Well, he was one of the most powerful, probably the most famous of all the Lydian kings in antiquity. Sardis sat in the powerful empire of Lydia. And when Lydia fell, when Croesus fell to Cyrus on his march toward Babylon, it was said that Cyrus claimed from Croesus $600 million in gold. We're talking 2,500 years ago. So if we backed up right now 100 years, early 20th century, $600 million would be equivalent now to, nowadays to $2.2 billion. And so we can back up another 2,400 years from there, and we begin to understand the opulence and the wealth and therefore the significance of Sardis. It was actually claimed in the first century that even though, as we've seen, the Greco-Roman world was deplorable, and idolatry and sexuality were rampant, because of the opulence and therefore the opulent lifestyle of the inhabitants of Sardis, and because of the rank sexual, cultish promiscuity that existed there, that Sardis was derided in the first century as the worst of all the ancient cities, the most deplorable. So, we're gonna do a little journey again, putting this in modern context. Ephesus, we've said, is equivalent to New York City. Okay, very, very important, very influential, very famous. Smyrna to the north is equivalent kind of to Beverly Hills, Hollywood, LA, Pergamum, Washington, D.C. It's where the laws, crooked as they are, come out. And then you come to Thyatira, as we saw, and we're like, it's a suburb, it's not important, it's not influential, it's kind of marginalized, no one ever hears about it. It's Clearwater, right? And then, that's what we said, that's what it would be equivalent to. And then you come down to Sardis, and Sardis is Las Vegas. Sin City, even in its day. I mean, as awful as the Greco-Roman world is, that is Sardis for us. Everything is pleasure-seeking, pleasure-loving. The chief god of the city of Sardis was a hermaphrodite god who was castrated upon her birth. Her name was Cybele. She was a god of the Lydian Empire. And this chief goddess was seen in her masculinity as the goddess of the sky with perfect vision, all-knowing, and yet also a goddess of the earth where she cared well for the citizens of Sardis. She was the goddess of fertility. By the first century, she was beginning to be replaced by the Greco-Roman god Artemis Diana. And so they were seen as equivalent, goddess of fertility, goddess of life. And yet what was very interesting is here in this fertile crescent, Pactolus River flowing through it, small Pactolus River, large Hermes River flowing beside it, right on the cusp of the mountains, beautiful city. The fourth largest temple in antiquity was the temple to Cybele, this goddess of the Lydians, the goddess of Sardis. And yet rising up in the background is not only the Acropolis of the city, the highest point, which we'll talk about here in a second, but also is what was called the necropolis, from necros. It was an ancient burial ground for the dead, and literally at a certain point of day, the necropolis would cast a shadow, the shadow of death, as it were, over the beauty of the false promise of Cybele, of life. And it's little wonder why Jesus reveals himself the way that he does here. As you come into the text, and he says, to the angel of the church of Sardis, write this, the one, look at it with me, the words of him who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Why is that a big deal? So my dad was here last weekend. You guys saw him if you were here. He was a preacher, 6'8", so he's taller than me, bigger than me. And I'll never forget, growing up, we were a tight-knit family, and we would go out, lived in Goldsboro, North Carolina at the time, and we would go out and we'd play wiffle ball together almost every afternoon. My dad was in town. So wiffle ball, And I'd be on my dad's team, and Nate, my older brother, would be on my mom's team, and then the neighborhood kids would come around, and we would all play together. And so on one occasion, my mom is pitching to my dad, and you gotta stand kind of close, you know, it's wiffle ball, so you don't have a lot of control there. And so she's pitching, and I don't remember all the details exactly, but I remember what happened. She pitched, she threw this ball. My dad, he was just a powerful monster, he still is, and he could literally hit it over top of our home. We had a small home, Baptist preacher, but he could hit it over top of the home, and so we were just like, you win, like you're just all powerful. And but that day, he did not hit it over the home, he hit it right into my mom's face, right in the center, right off her nose. Now, if that happened to my dad, I think as a seven-year-old, I would have been like, I would imagine the wiffle ball would just combust. You know, he'd just radiate glory and strength. But for my mom, she froze. I still remember, she froze, and then the waterworks burst, and then she covered her face, and she just kind of collapsed. I feel like she fell straight back onto the ground, like slain in the spirit style. But she fell backwards, and all the neighborhood kids gathered around my mom, which they would have never done for my dad. Right? They were never done. Because my dad, and all his power and all of his glory and all of his strength as a dude, was not my mom in all her sweets and intricate, sensitive fragility. Okay? And I get there's some of you ladies who are like, don't classify me like, and that's fine. Believe me, I won't. Okay? But that's how it was for us growing up. Like my dad was the picture of Lord Protector, which was terrifying. But it was also terrifying for my adversary, so it worked out. And my mom was this picture of care and grace and compassion. And we understand that. We understand that, typically speaking of humanity, that's typically how it works, that God has created helpers and caregivers, and he has created protectors and those who safeguard. But I think at times when we come to the Godhead, and specifically the person of Jesus, it's easy for us to only really consider one or the other. That he is either this kind and gracious and gentle caregiver, or he is the Lord Protector of Revelation 19 with a tattoo on his thigh and the sword at his waist. And what he's saying here is, I'm both. I am both. You have this false goddess, Cybele, who claims to be both, goddess of vision and goddess of care, but I am the true God of perfect vision. We see this actually in Revelation chapter 5, when he says there's five, he has seven eyes. In Revelation 5, seven eyes, the number of completion or perfection in the ancient world and in scripture, seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God commissioned out into all the earth. Speaking of his omniscience and his omnipresence, that he's everywhere. He is not all things, he is in or at presently at all things. And that would include time, across time. He sees all things, so he's perfect in vision, perfect as protector, and yet he's also holding in his hand the seven stars, which we've already heard in Revelation chapter 1, are the seven pastors. And so he's saying to us, I have perfect vision and perfect protection, but I also have perfect care for my people. And as such, so far superior to Cybele or to Artemis Diana, he says this. Middle part of verse number one. I know your works. Now, he's been saying this to all the churches. He's been saying this to us every single week. I know your urga, your energy, what you're doing. But all the other churches so far have received at least a sliver of commendation. So, hey, this is good. A little pat on the rump for us. Like, you're doing a good job. But Sardis gets none of that. I know your works. You have a reputation. It would almost be better if he had said nothing at all, because you just know what's coming now. Like, you have this reputation. People talk about you. We were in Vermont last week skiing, and Friday came around. We were supposed to fly out, and we were hoping we'd fly out. It was negative 28 with the wind chill, and so you never know what's going to happen there. The airplanes even work. And fortunately, we did get out, but it was delayed there in Burlington, and we had a connecting flight in JFK, and so every minute that we're delayed, as you know if you traveled, every minute we're delayed, we're closer to missing our connecting flight, and so finally we fly into JFK, and we hit the ground. We had about 13 minutes, and it's JFK. And sweetly, graciously, coincidentally, whatever you want to say, we were in the same terminal. because it could have been just a mess. Okay, you're driving to Queens to catch a flight or something. So we're in the same terminal, so we have to jet down. We pass the food court, and there's just lines and lines and lines of people. Nobody does it like Tampa International. There's lines of people, and I'm like, I can't eat anything there, but we hadn't eaten since like 10 a.m., and it's like 5 o'clock in the evening now. And so I'm like, hey, I have to get something. Daniel's like, I don't need anything. And so we make our way all the way to the end of the terminal, and there's this little, I don't know, inside shack thing set up. But at this shack thing set up right by our gate was a world-famous signature egg wrap. I mean, that's what it said. It said world-famous signature egg salad wrap. I'm like, oh, that's perfect. And I'm not even going to lie to you guys. In that moment, I thought to myself, I've been thinking about and musing on and meditating on Sardis. And I'm like, if this doesn't work, then it's going to be a sermon illustration. So it is now, okay? And so I get that. And our friends traveling with us are like, how is that? And I'm like, it's terrible. It's no wonder it's famous. It's absolutely terrible. Mushy, and it's been sitting there for a while and tasteless. Oh, that's cool. And so I ate it. Well, whatever. It was sustenance, sort of. And then we get on the plane, and we're sitting there on the jetway, and it's JFK again. Nobody does it like TPA. And so we're sitting there on the jetway for like an hour, waiting to take off. And something starts happening. Like something starts happening. I will not go into details for the sake of my poor wife and for your ears this morning. But if something starts, like pain, like the pains of what I imagine labor to be like. It was just pain for me. And I'm like, man, I don't know, like, something's gonna happen. So I look over at my wife, I'm like, look, that egg wrap thing. And you can kind of figure out what she was trying to say here, because I'm not going into detail, but she's like, I would rather you explode literally than anything happen. You just gotta, like, bottle that up and just deal with it, okay? And so I'm like, all right. So we get airborne. The stewardesses are starting to unbuckle. No one else is moving through the aisles, but I'm like, it's time. I did what the Lord has created us to do. And then, there was relief. There was relief that came, and I should have known better. Like, sometimes we can spot those things, like the egg wrap at JFK, and go, that's a bad idea. It's a bad idea. The reputation is not going to meet the reality. Like, they're not going to line up there. I don't care if it says signature. I don't care if it says world famous. It's not going to be good. We just know it. And there are other times where the reputation is far more deceptive. And it seemed like that was the case in the church at Sardis. You have this name, that's what the old King James says. You have this name, you have this reputation here in the ESV. And your reputation is that you're alive. And you're like, oh crap, like, I know what's coming. Because we've worked hard at this reputation. Like, we've learned our theology for this reputation. We're stoic and serious for this reputation. We've played the political game for this reputation. But you're dead. So here's the picture. In this place of supposed reputable beauty, cast over is the shadow of death, the necropolis. There's no life. There's no actual vitality. You have a name that you're alive, he says, a reputation, but you're dead. And we start to get insight a little bit into this middle of verse number 2 now. For I have not found your works, look at this, complete in the sight of God. Now, there's speculation about what this means. Right? What was the problem here? Why had this spiritual death occurred in the church and for so many in the church? Why had it happened? And there's some internal evidence as we read on through the text, and you'll see it here in a second, but the pollution of the garments and other indicators, but there's external evidence as well from the massive excavation that's been going on for the last 70 years of the city of Sardis. And what they've uncovered is that in the city of Sardis is the most massive synagogue in all the ancient world outside of the city of Jerusalem. Massive synagogue, but inside of the synagogue, surprisingly, they found statues to the Caesars and to the Roman gods. right outside of the synagogue is the marketplace. And as you went from one stall to another, the religion of the shopkeeper would be carved upon a piece of granite there in Sardis. Very beautiful. And so there's many gods, and there's testaments to the emperor there. And then you find the Star of David. So it seemed like there's this compromise going on. And interestingly enough, right beside the stall containing the Star of David, there is another stall, and it contains carved in the granite the Christian cross. And almost all scholars and all commentators have agreed that the only way that was possible is if you had compromised the one message of Christianity that really cannot be compromised, the exclusivity of Jesus. I've already said this throughout the weeks, like that in the ancient world, the emperors and the governors, the citizens, they didn't care if you worshiped Jesus. They just didn't care. As a matter of fact, it was good for morale. It was good for civilization a lot of times. They only cared if you worshiped him exclusively. And so if you would say, hey, I'm a Christian. I like living for Jesus. He helps me sleep at night, and he kind of bolsters my faith, and he kind of gets me through stuff. But I'm completely cool with Zeus, and I'm completely cool with Cybele, and I'm completely good with Apollo. I'm good with all these. Hey, whatever helps you, I totally get it. I mean, like, look, like, we have to be all things to all people, and we just kind of have to, like, live together. And so in the name of peace, in the name of camaraderie, in the name of living here, in the name of life, let's just kind of all get along. So I'm happy for you. Be happy for me that Jesus works for me, but you can kind of call Jesus whatever you want him to, and I'll kind of wink at that, and that'll be all right. And we'll set up shop here, and we'll live our lives in harmony, which is a problem, a massive problem. Because when the church stops standing for the exclusivity of Christ and his death and his resurrection and salvation by faith in him alone, the church has nothing left to stand in, and the flame of the gospel goes out. And you have this reputation that you're alive, and the people love you. They just love you. You're selling, your books are best-selling books. Hundreds of thousands of views on YouTube. Like, you're seen as you're respected. People love you in whatever sphere you're in. But the reason why is because there's been an incompletion of what is important. That's what he says. And so we just have to check ourselves here, because it's not like, well, they're a little off. It's not just, I get it, but he's so nice. Death is the word. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. I have found your works not complete in the sight of God. So look what he says here. Wake up, verse 2. So you might not be too familiar with the name Charles Templeton, but I think it's an important name for us to reference. Charles Templeton was a very impassioned, became very famous follower of Christ in the 1930s. And I think it was 1945, he encountered Billy Graham and they became best friends. Charles Templeton began to travel the world with Billy Graham, preaching at the Billy Graham evangelistic crusades. Was seen as this stalwart of the faith. Very eloquent, very serious, very articulate. Until in the late 1940s, he began to have doubts. You know, skepticism entered in. He just saw Christians and how we behave and how we fail to live our beliefs a lot of times, and caused him to enroll in Princeton Theological Seminary, where his faith completely eroded and he embraced ardent agnosticism. He was confronted by Graham, and in his book, something like Dismissing God, Templeton writes about those encounters with Billy Graham and how no matter what the famed evangelist said, there was no recovering him. He knew there was no way of knowing that God was. A few years later, a couple decades later, and I think it was the 1990s. Templeton is now in his 80s. And Lee Strobel, exploring the case for Christ and the writing of his book about it, interviewed Charles Templeton. And he said he was expecting hostility, and that's what he was met with initially. But even though Templeton was in his 80s and it was early onset Alzheimer's taking place, he said he was still a robust conversationalist. And so they converse there. You can read this in the book for yourself, but this is an excerpt. He says this, Strobel, seeking out evidence around Jesus, asked Templeton, and how do you assess this Jesus now? Now, after 20 years spent as a worldwide known, reputable evangelist, and now 40 years as an agnostic, how do you assess him now? It seemed like the next logical question, Strobel says, but I wasn't ready for the response it would evoke. Templeton's body language softened. It was as if he suddenly felt relaxed and comfortable in talking about an old and dear friend. His voice, which at times had displayed such a sharp and insistent edge, now took on a melancholy and reflective tone. His guard seemingly down, he spoke in an unhurried pace, almost nostalgically, carefully choosing his words as he talked about Jesus. He was, Templeton began, the greatest human being who has ever lived. He was a moral genius. His ethical sense was unique. He was the intrinsically wisest person that I've ever encountered in my life or in my readings. His commitment was total and led to his own death, much to the detriment of the world. What could one say about him except that this was a form of greatness? Strobel says, I was taken back. You sound like you really care about him, I said. Well, yes, he is the most important thing in my life, came his reply. He stuttered, searching for the right word. I know it may sound strange, but I have to say, I adore him. Everything good I know, everything decent I know, everything pure I know, I learned from Jesus. Just look at Jesus. He castigated people. He was angry. People don't think of him that way, but they don't read the Bible. He had a righteous anger. He cared for the oppressed and the exploited. There's no question that he had the highest moral standard and the least duplicity, the greatest compassion of any human being in history. There have been many other wonderful people, but Jesus is Jesus. Oh, but no, he said slowly. He's the most. He stopped, then started again. In my view, he declared, he is the most important human being who has ever existed. And that's when Templeton uttered the words I never expected to hear from him. And if I may put it this way, he said as his voice began to crack, I miss him. With that, tears flooded his eyes. He turned his head and looked downward, raising his left hand to shield his face from me. His shoulders bobbed as he wept. Templeton fought to compose himself. I could tell it wasn't like him to lose control in front of a stranger. He sighed deeply, wiped away a tear. After a few more awkward moments, he waved his hand dismissively. Finally, quietly but adamantly, he insisted, enough of that. And it was done. And a few years later, Charles Templeton stepped into eternity. He had a name, a reputation, a really, really powerful reputation of being alive, but by his own admission, he was always dead. He knew Jesus intellectually. He even, Hebrews 6, knew Jesus experientially. I miss him. I understand him. I miss him, and I know I'm putting words in his mouth, but I miss him as Savior and companion and friend, but I do not miss him as Lord of life. You have a name. So we have to ask ourselves today, do I have a name, a reputation of life, but I'm dead? I'm not saying, do you have a name of loving Jesus, but you're a sinner? That's all of us. I'm saying there's life absence, like a true walk with God and devotion with God. Has that ever taken place? Is it presence? The church at Sardis had this glowing reputation, but they were dead. Winston Churchill, in the early days of World War II, in one address to the nation of England, said this, I must drop one word of caution to the citizens of England. For next to cowardice and treachery, overconfidence leading to neglect and slothfulness is the worst of wartime crimes. And like, okay, we look around the suburbs of America today, especially in the reformed evangelical world, and I don't know if too often we get accused of cowardice or even treachery. I mean, I know accusations come all the time, right? But like consistently. But I think overconfidence leading to apathy, slothfulness, a grace-based lethargy is there at times. In Sardis, there was the necropolis overlooking the fertile plain, and there was also the Acropolis, 1,500 feet above the plains. I have a picture here of what is now ancient Sardis. And you can see, this is what it looked like. So here's the fertile plain. The city was down here in the basin. But the castle, the fortress, was up high on the cliffs, 1,500 feet, sheer cliffs above the city below. And whenever there was an invading army that would come in, the citizens would be alert, and they would all flock to the fortress, and there was water, and there was food, and there was this natural moat around the base of it from the Pactolus River. And the citizens felt safe, and the nobility felt safe, and the governors felt safe. It was impenetrable. In the ancient world, it was seen as unconquerable. And yet twice, as I already alluded to, it was conquered. In all of their kind of apathy and complacency, the people would get inside the wall. And the first time was in 587 BC when Cyrus the Persian came up against the city. And for 11 months, he sieged the city, and there was no access. And the people were doing well. Everything was fine. Until one evening, the reports were that one of the soldiers in Sardis leaned over the castle wall, and his helmet tumbled down below. And so one of the Persian guards on the outside was watching, and he saw, after a few moments, this soldier of Sardis emerge from a secret passage in the wall and make his way down a small snake path to retrieve his helmet. And he made his way back up. And of course, the Persian then went and told Cyrus, and Cyrus went on the other side of the city and began to conduct his campaign of military prowess against the city. And so all the soldiers of Sardis raced to that side. And meanwhile, just a few soldiers made their way up that snake path and entered into the backside of the fortress and opened the city gates. And the powerful kingdom, impenetrable kingdom of Croesus, fell. And you would have thought they learned their lesson, but 333 years later, Antiochus the Great came up and sieged the city for over a year. And so they finally found that the people were so complacent and so comfortable inside the city walls that there was a section of the city where they would actually drop the remains of deceased animals. And so they left it unguarded. They thought no one possibly would make their way through this to attack the city. And so the soldiers of Antiochus the Great found this. And in the dead of night, cover of darkness, they made their way into the city, opened up the city gates, and for a second time in four centuries, the city fell. So is it any wonder why Jesus says, the one who holds the seven stars, the one who has perfect vision, seven spirits of God, is it any wonder why he says this? Wake up, strengthen what remains and is about to die. Remember then, verse 3, what you have received and heard, keep it and repent. If you will not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come against you. So you've been lulled into this complacency. You have a reputation of being alive, but you're just not. Wake up, or I'll come like a thief. My four-year-old Augustine, he has really good intentions when we sit down to watch a movie as a family, really good intentions of making it through the movie. But he hardly ever does. By halfway through, he'll fall asleep. And so it'll be a Saturday afternoon. We're all chilling together as a family, and he'll fall asleep, and then Daniel will go in, start prepping dinner, and then she'll be like, hey, it's time for dinner. Can you peaceably wake up Augustine? And if you're not a parent, let me just fill you in on something. There's no such thing as peaceably waking up a four-year-old. You just can't, maybe you have like that angelic being. Augustine's not that. And so at first I'm like, hey, buddy, you doing all right? And then the eye will pop open, he'll kind of stare at me, and then he goes back to sleep. So now I just pick him up, and I stand him in the center of the room. And he'll wobble and almost fall over. He hasn't fallen over yet. And that kind of wakes him up. And he's so angry. I mean, he's so angry. He would do damage if he could, okay? But he's so angry. But I'm like, hey, there's no nice way of waking you up. There's no nice way. Like, I don't know how to go about this. And the people who least want to hear the wake-up call today are the people who need to hear it most. And there's really no nice way of saying this. There's three people that emerge here in this passage. There are those who are truly dead. And you need that initial wake-up call of regeneration to happen today. And I pray that it would, where you would come from death to life. Then there are others who the flame is flickering. It's about to go out. That's who he says to here, strengthen what remains, which is about to die. Some of us need to hear that. And some of us don't want to hear that. We just don't want, I mean, it's Super Bowl Sunday for crying out loud. It's like the apex of our sports world. We don't want to hear this. We're succeeding in life. We're succeeding at our job. Like, Christianity is on the margins for us, and we're very comfortable with that, like the citizens of Sardis was. And the word is, wake up. Wake up and strengthen what remains. And it's a jarring word. And there are a few here who have not soiled their garments, is the word, which all kinds of images come to mind there, but they have not blemished their garments of righteousness in Christ. They have not tarnished that reputation. Their reputation lines up with their confession and their lifestyle. And so look what he says here, wake up, strengthen, that's sterizo in the Greek. We get steroid from that. It's an outside force strengthening the body, strengthening the soul, strengthen what remains. So we can't do it ourselves. Like my dad talked about last week, it has to be a continual reliance on the Spirit, strengthen what remains and is about to die. Verse number 3, remember. This is how you strengthen that. Remember. Remember what you have received and heard. And then keep that. It's not enough just to remember it and to know it, but keep that and repent. And we've talked about that a lot. To turn from. And I know it's a hard word. I know that. I get that. Like, I feel that. We were coming into Tampa from JFK on JetBlue. I don't know if they practice landing a lot on JetBlue, on airlines. But I'm saying that in a nice way. Like, we landed, and I hardly knew we were on the ground. You know, sometimes it's like you land, and you're skidding all over the place, and you're like, Lord, please. And but this was like, you know, they're like, hey, we're going to be landing in a second. And then, like, we were on the ground. And it was like the smoothest, softest, so nice that at first I was like, oh, man, that's amazing. This guy should get raised. And then I started to think, for just a second, is he going to apply the brakes? I mean, is he like one of those pilots who's just like, I want to make them as comfortable as possible. So let's just ease into this bad boy and run off the runway and blow up. Because I would hate for anybody to be uncomfortable, right? That'd be, we understand that's nonsensical. Do the brakes have to be applied? That's what Jesus is doing here. He's saying, my goal is not to make you as comfortable as possible. This is not a passenger aircraft. Buckle up, it's gonna be a fun ride. It is wake up. Wake up. You gotta do it. And if you're looking at somebody else to wake up this morning, you're missing the point. Wake up and strengthen what remains, he says. It's a tough word to hear. Verse number 4. Yet you have still a few names in Sardis, people who have not soiled their garments, and they will walk with me in whites. For they are worthy, which is so weird, that Jesus would say they are worthy when you come 2 chapters later in chapter 5, and the angel says with a loud voice to John, the writer of the book, who is worthy? Who is axios? That's the word. Who can handle the weight and gravity of the pleasures and the purposes and the goodness of God? And the word is nobody. So here Jesus is like, and they will walk with me because they're worthy. And you're like, contradiction in the Bible, right? Let's throw it away. No. What he's saying here is very clear in the context and in the entirety of the passage. They're not worthy. Like, they're not actually, practically worthy. Let me explain it this way. Back in 2021, we drove down to a game. We were up in North Georgia at the time. We drove down to a game at Truist Park. I might have talked about it. And we went to see the Braves play. Braves are my team. Lost the game to the Yankees. I took my 2 oldest kids with me. We had to park like 2.5 miles from the stadium in this hotel parking lot where we were way grossly overcharged for parking. And I wondered if my car would still be there, but it was. And so we come out of the game at the end of the game, and 2.5 miles, we got to hoof it back to my truck. And so Spurgeon's beside me, and we had friends with us, and Evie just, you know, she made like 100 yards, and she's like, I can't do it. I can't. And so I lift her up, and I put her on my shoulders, and I am blazing a trail. And at first, she's like, this is so fun. Like, this is amazing. Oh, yeah. And then about halfway in, she's like, how much longer? How much longer is this going to be? And then we finally get there around the corner, and the SUV comes into view, and she's like, we made it. And I could have been like, you're an idiot. We didn't do anything. I did this. You're here because of me, my strength and my glory, you know? I didn't say that. Might have thought it for a second. No, I did not. I did. But I was like, yeah, baby girl, we did. We made it. It's so easy for us as Christians, And believe me, I'm not saying we don't mortify sin and that we don't strive forward and that we don't work hard and we're not diligent. Like, believe me, there's enough laziness and impertinence in the kingdom of God. Like, that's ridiculous. That's not what I'm saying at all. But what I'm saying is I think we like to take credit a lot of times for what only Jesus can do. And he says here, they'll walk with me in whites. Whose robes are those? They're his robes, not ours. We didn't go to the river and clean it up. He came to us in his righteousness and he clothed us in them. And he says, they will walk with me in white because they're worthy. And we're like, whose worthiness is that? And it's Jesus. It was just like really good. Look, if you're like looking for that like build you up sermon today, let me just build you up, all right? All of us know, if we can be dead level honest, how jacked up we are. Yep. How messy we are. And so all this masquerade of like, well, but I'm worthy. No, you're not. That's right. Okay, you're just not. I'm not worthy. None of us are worthy. Jesus is worthy. And in radical, undeniable grace that we can't understand, he says, I choose to make you in me worthy. Right. I'm worthy. And so, let the condemnation come, because there isn't any legitimate condemnation anymore. Let the accusations fall, because there isn't any actual accusation anymore. Shelf the pride, because there's nothing to be proud about except for the boast that we have in the worthiness of Jesus, who says to us, you will walk in white, because you're, he doesn't look at us and go, you're an idiot, like I did all this. He says, well done. I mean, I carried you the whole way. The whole way, but well done, good and faithful servant. Life, even the life here comes from him. And so we wake up, and they will walk with me in white, for they're worthy. The one who conquers? There's only one, Revelation 5, who conquers, Nikeo. We get Nike from that, victor. The one who conquers, we clothe us in white garments, and I will never blot his name out of the book of life. I will not remove him from the registry. That was popular in the Roman cities there. I will, watch this, I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Which is very interesting, because what seems like had happened in Sardis is they had failed to rightly confess the name of Jesus. But he says, if you wake up and you will rightly confess my name by faith, according to my grace, And that's it. Then I will confess you in my conquest and in my worthiness before my Father. And that's what we need to hear. I know, like, some of us are like, and we need to hear, like, that you need to do this and this and this and this. No, I've always contended that takes care of itself if we're alive. If we're alive, so are we alive in Christ? Is there a name that we confess by faith? His conquest, by faith in him, true faith, our conquest, his worthiness, now our worthiness in him. Let's pray. Father, I pray for those who are asleep today, for those who the fire is waning, for those who lack life and are just content somehow to play this game, this reputable, appropriate, somehow in our crazy minds, honorable game of religiosity and supposed allegiance to Jesus. God, I pray that there will be repentance of the name that we confess and yet the death that we live in or that we flirt with. God, I do pray for my friends who are here who are walking, truly walking in faithfulness. Not a prideful deception, but true faithfulness to you. legitimately before you, not according to all the standards of religiosity around us and the judgment of those around us, but true allegiance and devotion to you. God, I pray that we would not become proud or deceived, but that we would continue forward to pursue you and to worship Christ and to rejoice in his worthiness credited to us, his blamelessness received by faith. Pray for my friends who have never come to life in Christ. They have not been awakened. God, I pray that you would do for them what they can't do. We can't conjure life. So I pray that you would create it by your Spirit. I pray for those of us who are apathetic, suburbians who play the game and check the boxes, and we have the name, and yet death is right around the corner. God, I pray that you would revive today. Revive our souls.